You're now listening to Sound Talent Media. Check out more shows at soundtalentmedia.com.
I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the rinds, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. Swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, find nothing but faith in nothing. Wanna put my tender heart in a blender, watch it spin round to a beautiful oblivion.
Hey friends, today's guest is Max Collins, lead singer and bass guitarist for the Los Angeles, California rock band, 6's. Max and I get down to business breaking down their mega smash hit, Inside Out, taken from their first self-titled album released in 1998. The birth of the song is unlike any story I've heard on the podcast up to this point. Max takes us through the initial process of writing the song and how it attracted the brass at RCA Records, who signed the band while they were still in high school. We talked about the oddity of what makes a hit song and why, for whatever reason, some of the greatest songs never make it onto the radio. Max was super complimentary as to what producer Don Gilmore brought to the table and how Don was able to take the sheer excitement and raw talent of such a young band and harness that into a number one rock record. And we shared a laugh over the time Max found himself standing at a urinal next to Fred Durst of Limp Bizkit and how that conversation had a direct correlation to Inside Out. For all this and a whole lot more, don't touch that dial.
Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Chris DeMakes a podcast.
I was born in New York City, but then when I was like four, we moved to Coconut Grove, Florida.
Oh, okay.
And then I moved out here right before the sixth grade. And I actually saw your band. I'm sure you won't remember this show, but it was an all-ages venue in Canoga Park.
Oh, I remember. And it was December of 95, I believe.
Holy hell. Yeah.
Yeah. That's when we got signed. That's when we got signed to Capitol. My mom, dad, grandma, and brother were out there.
No
I know
way.
Exactly the show you're. Yeah. That was late December of 95, like around December 21st, 22nd.
It's driving me crazy that I can't remember what that place was called. I don't remember, but I do remember seeing another show there. It was probably the same promoter, too. And the promoter maced everyone. No, we were playing. What am I talking about? We were on stage. And like there was maybe a pit, I guess. I doubt it could have been a very, you know, frightening one. Yeah. Next thing we knew, we were like choking on pepper spray.
Always a good time.
Yeah.
the dangers of playing crappy clubs back in the 90s, right?
Oh, yeah.
So for the listeners, I want to give a little bit of history here. You know, researching you guys, it appears like you guys were still in high school when RCA Records came along. At the time, you were called 11teen, and you recorded an EP, but I couldn't find it online. Was that EP ever released? And were any of those songs on that EP of 11teen, did they ever make it to the self-titled record that came out in 98?
It wasn't formally released, no. It was just like, you know, we'd have it at shows and stuff like that. There was one song called Nocturnal Emissions that was repurposed on the second 6's record. It was just called Nocturnal. I can't remember how much of the original thing was actually preserved. I don't think that much of it.
Gotcha. Well, you know, I know like less than Jake's story where I came from, and it was just a lot of touring the underground punk rock circuit and the tape trading and the 7 inches and whatnot. And, you know, it just seems like you guys, I know you said you were playing some shows, but it seemed like, wow, you have this first record and all of a sudden the song we're going to talk about today, Inside Out, just gets on the radio. It seems from the outside looking in that this happened really fast for you guys. Or was there a building up to the first record?
No, I mean, it did, relatively speaking, happen extremely quickly, which I think was pretty infuriating for a lot of bands that did have to, you know, slog it out on the road for years and stuff. Yeah, our story is strange. We formed in high school in the 10th grade, and our original name was Yaku, And our original drummer was this guy, Kyle Briggs, who went on to play in the Hippos, who were, do you remember the Hippos?
Yeah. I know. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
So you played with Kyle.
Yeah. Kyle was our first drummer. We got him from
a small world,
an ad in the Recycler. And then he left the band and we got Nick Myers, who was a high school friend who's a couple years older. And yeah, so we were playing a lot of all ages venues, like the one that we just spoke about. We did a show at this place called the Natural Fudge Company. I don't know if you remember that place. It was in Hollywood, all tiny all ages place.
I don't, but did you guys ever play Dizzy Debbie's, the Chinese restaurant?
I think we did.
I've talked about that with Aaron from Real Big Fish on this show before, because what a wacky, and there was a couple Chinese restaurants that we were playing in the 90s. There was one in Seattle. It was like a thing for a minute.
Yeah.
Chinese restaurants were holding all ages punk shows. It was like, what the hell is going on?
I do remember a place. I don't remember what it was called, but it fits that description. It was like not a club. Yeah. Yeah. So we were doing a bunch of those all ages shows just on weekends and backyard parties and stuff like that, doing that whole thing, making flyers, all of that stuff. And, you know, and we would bring a lot of kids out. We did a show at this Natural Fudge Company spot, and someone from Dr. Dream Records was there.
That would have been Howard Benson, probably.
Howard Benson?
Well, Howard Benson ran Dr. Dream, and Howard ended up producing Less Than Jake. He went on to produce My Chemical Romance, Hoobastank, Daughtry. He's a
no. I mean, I know
producer
who Howard
now.
Benson is, but are we thinking of the same label, Dr. Dream? Like, it was this tiny label out of Orange County.
Absolutely. He put out the first Zebrahead album on Dr. Dream.
He did? I had no idea.
Yeah, that was Howard. That was Howard.
That's crazy.
Small world. Once again, small world.
I want to say the guy, the woman's name who saw us was named Jill. And then she liked us. She brought us down to the label and we met one of the dude who was in the Grabbers.
Okay.
I forget his name.
Remember that band. Well, you know what's crazy about all this too, Max, is, well, first of all, I want to go back to what you were talking about a moment ago and just say it wasn't a knock or a slight what I was saying about how you guys just, I mean, it's amazing what happened to you. I mean, there's only a small slot at radio. And the fact, I mean, you had a hit at radio. Not many people in the grand scheme of the world can say that, you know, and it's on your first record, boom, this song. And that song was everywhere in 98, as you know. So that in and of itself is a really cool thing.
No, I appreciate that. No, and I don't take it as a knock at all. I just, understandably so, was a perception of like, you know, these guys. Yeah, I mean, it was kind of an overnight thing compared to a lot of bands that were, you know, 10 years on the road in a van. But yeah, we ended up doing a deal with Dr. Dream. Steve Soto of the Adolescents was producing the record. We were cutting drums. And during those sessions, Dr. Dream had hooked up an radio interview performance thing with this company called Radio Asylum that was like a syndicated, underground syndicated radio show at the time. So she came to the studio. We recorded a few live songs for her show and a little interview. And her name was Jennifer Harold. And she just like really kind of loved our band and was like, I want to manage you guys. And we were like, okay. So while we were doing those sessions for Dr. Dream, she sent that recording of us playing live, which I'm sure sounded like hell, to Brian Maloof and Bruce Floor at RCA, who she had known, she had met just doing her thing over the years. And they liked it and flew out to LA to see a showcase that we did at that rehearsal space on Lankershim, the one that used to have the clouds painted on it, where like the Chili Peppers rehearse and stuff like that. It was like, for us at the time, a very fancy place. And yeah, I remember Brian Maloof and Bruce Floor being like 45 minutes late. And I was just like, oh, they're not going to come. I was like standing out on the curb, like nerdily and nervously, like waiting for the car to pull up. And they eventually came. We played a showcase for them. again, I remember it just being, I mean, we were high school kids. We were, you know, not that good. But you know what?
If you're worth your weight in salt as an A&R person or a label executive, you can see through the rough exterior, you know. And they obviously saw something. And I got to make mention of, and I mentioned this on the show before, you know, RCA Records by the mid-90s. I mean, they were kind of, I think people were saying it stood for the Recording Cemetery of America. 100. I mean, the label was pretty dead.
It was awful.
I mean, then you guys come along, and we're gonna get into the song here in a minute, but Inside Out's from your self-titled first record. It came out April 28th of 98, and Inside Out was released shortly thereafter in May of 98. The producer of the record was Don Gilmore, which I had the Popoff Brothers from Lit on here recently on the show, and they were talking about Don and how they loved the sound and the production and what he did with the Eve 6 record. Of course, they got signed to RCA, you know, a year later, A Place in the Sun comes out. So it's kind of cool to see what happened to RCA. And it seems like almost like you guys were the start of their rebirth.
Yeah. Which is funny. I mean, we were kind of a first for them in that wave for them. And yeah, they were, when we signed with them, yeah, really known for not being a very effective label for rock bands. And Don Gilmore hadn't produced a record of note either. He had done engineering work on some big records, but we heard a record that he'd done by a band called the Cunninghams out of Seattle that we thought sounded great. And he was also down to do it for a smaller budget, because when... I think you're exactly right. Like, they saw, RCA saw something in us. They did give us a record deal. It wasn't a production deal. It was a record deal, but it kind of in practice was a production deal, because it was like they wanted to see what we would turn into. And it was with the understanding that we'd finish high school. We were juniors in high school when we signed the deal,
which is incredible.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah, it is. It's really crazy. So we, toward the end of our senior year, played in a rehearsal room for our A&R guy a few of the songs that we had, one of which was Inside Out, but it was before Don Gilmore got to it. So it was like longer. There wasn't that G chord before the chorus. There was no bridge. And our A&R guy took us to Musso and Frank's afterwards, and he was like, yeah, I don't get it. He's like, I see you guys falling through the cracks.
That's always encouraging.
Yeah, no, I was fucking, I was so bummed. I mean, I was crestfallen, like, I, you know, and he was like, but I'm going to give you a little bit of money to get these songs off your chest. I was like, you condescending motherfucker. and so he did. We were able to hire Don for a cheap price. Our drummer at the time, who was not the drummer in the band when we got signed, a lot of people think we got signed out of nepotism. He was not the drummer when we got signed. Nick was. Nick left when the deal was offered. It freaked him out. And so we signed the deal with Nick, or after signing the deal, Nick left. And then we got Tony Fagenson to play drums. Tony Fagenson's dad is Don Was, the producer who did like Bonnie Raitt,
awesome,
and Rolling Stones, yeah, all that stuff.
Of course.
So he had Chomsky Recording Studios up in the hill. We were able to record for free. So that allowed us to be able to get these songs off our chest. We did that with Don. We recorded Inside Out, Showerhead, another song off the first record, and one more song. And our guy flew out, heard those, and was like, oh, okay, all right.
Now at this point, were these still demos? This wasn't what the final cut that made the record?
No, this would have been in various states of completion, the what would be the master recordings.
Oh, what would be the final thing?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so take us back to this time. You know, the record was in April of 98 when it was released. So we're talking fall of 97. You're recording somewhere around there. And do you recall actually writing Inside Out? Is it something that you had lying around for a while, or something organically that came with the band? Because in researching the song, it seems that the music is credited to the band, but you wrote all the lyrics. Is that correct?
Yeah. So the way it kind of worked with our band... You know, I mean, I would I would write on acoustic guitar, sometimes even bass. I played bass in the band. And, you know, I would write the lyrics and melody and bring them to the band. And then in the room, the rehearsal room or the bedroom or whatever it was, we'd flesh stuff out. Guys would come up with parts. We'd try out different things and other people's suggestions. Inside Out, in its first iteration, was an up-tempo, almost Social Distortion, like kind of swinging up-tempo song that had a completely different verse.
Is this something that Don molded into what it was, or did you guys? Because I mean, this song's a pocketed groove. It's not a it's not a Social Distortion type song at all.
Not at all.
It's very interesting that that's what it was.
No, initially. Don hadn't gotten to it yet. It was a friend of mine who said that they really liked the chorus but didn't really like the verse, and I was like, huh. So I, in, you know, my parents' bedroom, my bedroom at my parents' house was just like, let me see what I can do with it, and broke it to halftime, and yeah, wrote that verse, the first verse, you know, chords, melody, lyric. The second verse I literally wrote in English class in my junior or senior year. I guess it would have been junior year.
That is so cool, man. that's a trip. I don't know if I've never met anybody in 30 years of the business that wrote a song in high school that ended up being a hit of this magnitude. That's awesome. That's really cool.
Thanks, dude. Yeah. Well, it's funny because we were reading a novel by Carson McCullers. I can never remember the name of the book, but there was this ugly, sad juxtaposition thing that she would do in the novel, and I straight up plagiarized that in the song. I'm not as ugly sad as you.
That's great.
Yeah. So that much was done by us. What Don did was say, there's way too much information in this song. Like, the verses need to be shorter. Don was a really into like threes, like instead of having, you know, four cycles through in a verse, having one be clipped so that you're...
It's so funny you mention that, because this is in my notes. That's so interesting. On that first verse, it is in threes, not in fours. And I'd like to jump in right now,
yeah,
if we can.
Yeah, yeah.
And we'll get into this.
Yeah.
Inside Out is 3:39. Perfect rock radio time there. The song starts out, it's kind of like a pick scrape noise before the first chord rings out, and then it's just guitar and vocal, and it's an intro chorus.
Yeah,
you start with,
yeah,
you actually start with a chorus, and it's kind of got this personal vibe. And I'm gonna read the lyrics here. I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the rinds, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. Swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, find nothing but faith in nothing. Want to put my tender heart in a blender, watch it spin round to a beautiful oblivion. Rendezvous, then I'm through with you. And then there's two hits on the hi-hat, a single guitar string slide in, and the whole band is in for verse one. And before we get to verse one, I'm going to have you set up these lyrics. Before we go any further, though, were you pissed when Limp Bizkit stole your lyric for Nookie?
I was performatively pissed. I wasn't actually.
I mean,
pissed.
it's not like hey baby, let's rock and roll, like some generic lyric. I mean, tender heart in a blender is pretty specific.
Yeah,
that's plagiarism.
It was akin to, like, it was more like a sample because of the nature of the lyric. Yeah, it's not like he was saying, like he said, you know, baby, I want to hold you tonight or some shit. It's like, this is, you know, this is very clearly coming from this song. He told me about, so I ended up randomly in a bathroom with him at some bar. Like, I was just, I'm taking a piss, and at the urinal next to me is Fred Durst. And he's like, hey man, I used one of your lyrics in my song. And,
and you're like, no shit.
I was like, no shit. Yeah, I think at this point the song was out. I don't remember what I said, but But yeah, no, it's just one of those sort of just fucking bizarre things that, you know, little moments.
Totally bizarre. Set up these first lyrics here. This usually we get to the chorus and talk about it, but because this song starts with the chorus, so I just read them through and kind of set this up. What you're feeling here? What it's about?
I think I'm attempting to just articulate a feeling. I mean, I reductively kind of, you know, refer to it as teen angst or whatever. I don't think that's, I mean, that's like kind of insanely broad, but it's also not incorrect. When I was writing all these songs, I had a very specific girl in mind who, like, I was absolutely in love with, totally broke my heart, all of those predictable things. But this song does get to larger themes, however imperfectly.
I mean, for an 11th grader, there is some poetry going on here. I got a tip of the hat to you. I mean, I've never heard anybody refer to rinds in a song, like the rind of a fruit,
yeah,
or something.
Yeah.
You know, and it's different, you know. And for a 16-year-old kid, it's, I don't know. I don't know if the word deep is what the word is, but it's different. It's cool.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Hi, podcast listeners. I'm Carol Costello, a former CNN anchor and national correspondent. This January, I'm launching a podcast about one of the first cases I ever covered as a journalist. It's one that stuck with me all of these years, the one that buried itself under my skin and stayed put. It's a true crime series about an amazing woman named Phyllis Cottle, who defied torture and death and brought a fierce rage to the quest to find her attacker. Carol Costello Presents Blind Rage is a production of Evergreen Podcasts and signature title of the Killer Podcast Network. Listen and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Discover more great true crime and paranormal programming at killerpodcast.com.
I think there's sort of like a theme on that first record of like uncertainty, you know, the find nothing but faith in nothing thing. I guess we're not at the chorus yet, but I think, you know, the way I've always kind of written is to kind of tap into this like kind of fugue state where I'm like playing with phonics. I'm playing with the way words sound. I don't necessarily know what I'm going to say until something kind of appears, like phenomena that feels compelling, that feels interesting, not boring, you know. So something is okay, that this thing has my attention, and I get there by just kind of making sounds with my mouth, basically, like sort of seeing what phonetics feel good and what words kind of attach themselves, and building it like that, you know. And I know a lot of writers start with a title or know that they're writing about something very specific.
That's such an awesome point you made. I have to stop you there real quick. Just about that phonetics. And sometimes as songwriters, you just be kind of, we call it scatting along just nonsense words when you're writing a melody. And then you go write lyrics and it never hits you with that same emotion. You have to go back and actually, sometimes you end up using those first words.
Oh, 100%.
Because it hits you a certain way, and the new word, even though the lyric might be a little more clever or better, it's not as good.
100%, and I'm so much a believer in sacrificing clever for the way things sound / feel, because it's like,
yeah,
you know, it's not poetry. It's songwriting. It's a different thing, and especially for like anything that you could consider like rock. Like my favorite songs, so often the ones that feel most transcendent, I haven't the faintest idea what the fuck they're talking about. But yeah, there's yeah, there's like the way the words sound is so important.
Yeah, someone that comes to, a couple of bands come to mind, like the Cars or Prince, or they were singing totally. Sometimes, like, what are they singing about? It just made you feel good.
Exactly, you know? Exactly.
Made you rock. I want to get into the first verse now, and going back to what you're talking about with Don and threes, these lyrics kind of go in threes here, and I call it nine, and the second verse is only six times, and it might be kind of hard for the listeners to visualize. I'll try to break it down here. Verse one, I burn like a wicker cabinet, chalk white and oh so frail. I see our time has gotten stale. That's one. The tick-tock of the clock is painful, all sane and logical. I want to tear it off the wall. That's two. I hear words and clips and phrases. I think sick like ginger ale. Love that line. My stomach turns and I exhale. That's the third part of the first verse. Couple things here, and what I want you to break down the lyrics. At the part where it says, I want to tear it off the wall, is that your drummer Tony Fagenson doing an overdub on his hi-hats? Is that part of the original drum track? Or are there shakers of some kind that come in there? It's really interesting. I can't really tell.
I think there are shakers that come in there. I could be wrong.
It's definitely shakers later, but there I couldn't really tell. And it's just a cool little thing that comes in and makes you go, you know, and I really like that part. The first harmony, vocal harmonies that we hear in the song come in on, I hear words and clips and phrases, I think sick like ginger ale. That's in on the last line, it's you alone. Was that something that Don came to, or was that something you had thought of?
Before Don came into the picture, John and I, John Siebel's the guitar player of 6's, we played with harmonies a lot, and so much so that our A&R guy at RCA referred to us as the Everly Brothers of punk, because we did a lot of that.
Well, real quick, yeah. I gotta, not to interrupt you, I want to stop you there, because, you know, I assumed that it was you singing with yourself the harmonies on the record. Is that actually John doing the harmonies?
On that first record, the majority of the harmonies are John. I don't think I did any.
The reason I ask, I went back, I saw you guys on Letterman. I went and saw some live performances of the song, and damn, it sounded awesome. Like, you guys can sing together. So it wasn't like, you know, because a lot of times the lead singer will track his harmonies and you see him live, like,
really
cut it. But you could tell, I was like, wait a second, I think he's doing the backing vocals. It's awesome.
Yeah, I literally didn't know how to, I couldn't sing harmonies at that time. I couldn't divorce the melody from my brain. I mean, now
that's
it's
the hardest.
I love writing harmonies. I love singing harmonies. And I do on a lot of the, you know, on the newer 6 stuff that we've just started to put out, but we still use John's voice a lot because he's a great harmony singer, has a really high voice, can hit high notes and full voice.
Awesome. Set up this first verse. There's a lot of imagery here. I burn like a wicker cabinet. You got the line, I hear words and clips and phrases. I think sick like ginger ale. You know, ginger ale was given to me as a kid when I had an upset stomach. Is that what that was? I guess set up the verse for you.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
Yeah. I mean, hearing you read them, I'm realizing that they are all, I mean, wicker cabinets. Like, we had, they weren't cabinets, but they were like, we had this like white wicker furniture at my parents' house. That's where that came from. Think sick like ginger ale. Absolutely. When I was sick, my mom would get me ginger ale. you know, and I can also hear how, again, I'm letting phonetics lead, you know, because like wicker cabinet, like it wasn't a cabinet, but cabinet's going to sound better than whatever the object actually was, like,
yeah, a wicker chair or whatever.
Yeah, totally. You know, and again, I'm not even sure what I'm saying. I think I'm just like, you know how it is when you're like, you're kind of in that place and it's sort of like the waking dream time and you can just kind of explore stuff.
Yeah. Well, at the 57-second mark, just shy of a minute, we hit the first chorus. And of course, we've already heard the first chorus at the intro, but now it's full band. And again, I'll read the lyrics. I would swallow my pride. I would choke on the rinds, but the lack thereof would leave me empty inside. I would swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, find nothing but faith in nothing. Want to put my tender heart in a blender, watch it spin round to a beautiful oblivion. Rendezvous, then I'm through with you. And what a groove here. You can really hear the bell on the ride cymbal, which that in and of itself is a hook here.
Yeah.
I would swallow my pride, I would choke on the rhymes, but the lack thereof will make me empty inside. I would swallow my doubt,
but faith in nothing. I wanna put my tender heart in a blender, watch it spin around to a beautiful oblivion.
You know, a lot of times the drummer, you know, it doesn't get credit for being a hook in a song. And just the way that that bell comes out there is awesome. There's vocal harmonies throughout, up to where it says turn inside out. And then the band stops on Find Nothing But Faith in Nothing. The guitar slide comes back in. And right there, there's a harmony on the rest of the chorus throughout it. And at the very end, sounds like a shaker this time, right before the second verse begins. A kind of little bit of nuance there. It's really cool. But at the part where it says tender heart in a blender, right there, it sounds like it's almost like a Leslie or a tremolo effect on a guitar that comes in. Is that what that is?
Probably. I don't totally remember.
And was that something that Don probably suggested in the studio 100%, as a layer?
100%. That would have been a Don suggestion, as well as the weird chord before the chorus that I honestly think makes the song. Like, I think like that's the thing that makes that chorus satisfying. It's a monotone. It's a one note chorus. It's like an amelodic chorus, but like having that tension right before it hits is what makes it satisfying, I think.
That's awesome. Well, it pretty much goes right into the second verse. And before we get into the second verse, up to this point in the song, Max, do you recall the arrangement? I know you said Don, you know, had done stuff with it, but not counting when it was the Social Distortion song. But when you were in that studio now, Don was a studio, and you're tracking the song. Was the song pretty much the same up to this point, or was there changes going on?
The song, the blueprint of the song we'd gotten in pre-production with Don. So we knew what we were dealing with like the timestamp. The only part that didn't exist yet was the bridge lyric and melody.
Okay, which we're going to get to that, which the bridge in this song is killer. verse two, I'm going to read it out here, and I'll let you set this one up. And in my notes, I wrote, this is a third shorter than verse one, and I'll illustrate that to the listeners. SoCal is where my mind states, but it's not my state of mind. I'm not as ugly, sad as you. That's one. Or am I origami? Crazy lyric. Again, for a 16-year-old kid, it's deep.
Thanks.
Fold it up and just pretend. Demented as the motives in your head. And that's the second part. Here, those three lines of verse two. The second part here from Or Am I Origami On, there's a vocal harmony throughout there, not in the first half, which is cool.
I'm not as ugly, sad as you. Or am I origami? Fold it up and just pretend. Demented as the motives in your head.
Set this up. Where did the origami line come from? That's different.
Yeah, again, I think it's just playing with phonetics. It's following or am I, right? It's the question is or am I, and I'm sure, you know, I had cultivated by that point a mind that's looking for the thing, you know, that the way to play with words and sounds, and that probably just popped out. The words or am I, I'm sure, made me think of the word origami, you know?
Yeah, I again, Rhines, that's one, and origami. I don't think I've ever heard those in a song before or after this, so.
Yeah. Wait, so I'm blanking on how the second verse opens. It's
SoCal is where my mind states, but it's not my state of mind.
Right, yeah. I think, yeah, and that's just illustrating just feeling like every high school kid does probably that you're an alien, you're an outsider or whatever. SoCal is where my mind states, but it's not my state of mind. I'm not as ugly, sad as you. That's my plagiarism from the Carson McCullers novel.
anybody ever call you out on that or recognize that?
No one ever did. She's a really interesting.
Hopefully you don't get a call from the publisher. Now.
Figure. Yeah.
I shouldn't have been on your podcast.
That'd
damn
be
it.
Really funny. I'm not as ugly, sad as you, or am I origami, folded up and just pretend, demented as the motives in your head. Yeah, I'm just playing with sounds and words. Like, it doesn't really run deeper than that, but they are words that I think do the thing where they offer themselves up to the listener to project whatever they're feeling onto them in a way that only songs that are done by painting with abstraction do. It's like, if you have a super specific lyric, I think it's harder for the listener to like literally make it their own, to like, it, you know, put on to the song whatever happens to be going on in their life, or whatever they happen to be worried about or excited about or whatever, sad about, whatever it may be. So I think, like, again, that's some of the kind of accidental value in the song, like looking at it objectively decades later.
I had no idea. I love the fact that you wrote this when you were in high school. It's amazing to me.
Thanks, man.
It's amazing. Getting into chorus, chorus three, it's actually the second full chorus is the band, but it's the third time you hear the chorus because the song opens with a chorus. I'm not going to read all the lyrics again, but there's vocal harmonies throughout this chorus again, except for the stop in the middle, find nothing but faith in nothing. And I noticed here when listening, and I'm going to assume, Max, that this record was tracked to tape and not to Pro Tools?
Correct.
Okay. And the reason I say that, you know, a lot of times, when especially in the pop world, when you're going for radio, it's copy and paste in Pro Tools or Logic, whatever. You're just going to keep putting the same harmonies. And I notice there's a thing known as sibilance. For the listeners, that's like the S's and the T and the P sounds are very harsh. On the first time you say faith, it really comes out harsh. And the first time, this time it's a little more subtle. And that's when I recognized, okay, that definitely wasn't copy and pasted. And I notice also that the harmony sounds different. It's the same, I think John was going for the same thing, but just it was sung a little different on Heart in a Blender, as I love that harmony on that line. From the first chorus to the second, it's different, and that's so cool.
I'm so with you. It's so, hearing that now is, it's like just so refreshing. Yeah, because like so much new stuff that comes out is so copy pasted, perfected, and yeah, you don't hear those slight changes from.
There's some push pull going on here. You know, I had a guest on recently. We were talking about that. It's nice when things don't have to line up perfectly. It's, you couldn't figure out in the early days of the band why, you know, people didn't like our recordings, because it didn't sound like us. We were trying to make everything sound so tight and perfect, but that wasn't what we sound like live.
Yeah.
There's an energy there. There's that push pull that the people hear. And I really noticed that there. We get done with chorus three, and we're at 2 minutes and 2 seconds. And we're in the bridge, which is the instrumental part. And after you say, I'm through with you, I believe you say rendezvous again. I couldn't find that in any lyric sheets on Google, but I think you say rendezvous that goes into the ooh-oohs.
Oh, yeah. You know,
I almost thought it was through with you, but I really listened to the headphones. I think it says rendezvous, and you're doing the ooh-oohs.
It is, and that's not my voice. That I think that's a comp. That's either Don or John, or a combination of both.
I noticed that Don does some, it's credited with some backing vocals on the record, as well as production, engineering, and mixing the album, which is cool. I'm always about that when you bring in extra voices, because it's neat and you can't tell. And I would have just assumed that was you or John, but it may be Don.
Don has an incredible voice for harmony and knack for writing them. Yeah, he's like the 90s, 2000s Mutt Lang, like, crazy high kind of like great pitch voice.
That's awesome. Well, at the 2 minute and 13 seconds, so about 12 seconds after the instrumental bridge part, we get into the lyrical part, and right off the top, that tremolo guitar, which is really pronounced now, comes in here, and it just It just gives it a different texture. The oohs on the vocals are now tucked a little lower. They're behind everything here.
Are you alone and the one you don't know you need to keep feed your ego? Make me blind when your eyes close, sink when you get close, tie me to the bedpost. Are you alone and the one you don't know you need, you don't know you need me? Make me blind when your eyes close.
Throughout most of this, there's a really cool low register vocal harmony, except the very last line, the tie me to the bedpost line, which we'll get to in a moment. But I'm going to read these lyrics and have you set it up. I alone am the one you don't know you need. Take heed, feed your ego. Make me blind when your eyes close. Sink when you get close. Tie me to the bedpost. I am alone am the one you don't know you need. You don't know you need me. But make me blind when your eyes close. Tie me to the bedpost. And there's a dynamic here. The band stops. It's really cool on bedpost. And then just on the word post, there's a high harmony holdout that goes underneath the final chorus that comes in. It just is killer.
Make me blind.
So this is the elusive bridge that you didn't have. How was this written?
Don said, Max, we need a bridge. Take that guitar and go into the pool room and write a bridge. And I swear to God, it took me like 7 minutes. Like it just popped out. And hearing it now and hearing, like, it's so funny. I can pick out the influences so clearly. And they're so disparate. Like the I alone thing is straight up radio rock getting into my head, because that live song was everywhere. The I alone love you, I alone tempt you, whatever that song was.
I think it was live.
It was live.
Was that live?
Yeah, it was live.
It was live. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
So there's that. There was this songwriter guy, Will Harrison, who we did another tiny all ages show with, who was a really good writer and also like kind of out of his mind. But we made friends with him. We actually recorded a demo for him in John's dad's tiny little studio. Some crazy stories with him. Like he called me once at my parents' house and was like, hey man, I just got out of a mental institution, or a 5150 for spitting on a Scientologist. Do you want to come, pick me up and we'll like play some guitar? And I was like, sure. And I went and picked
file under stuff I wouldn't do today.
Yeah. I went and picked him up. We played guitar. Like we went to some random person's house. We like busked on the street for a minute. Anyway, he had a song and the lyric was, take heed as you speed your ego to your island of lies. And I mean, what's my line? Take heed, feed your ego. So that's definitely in there. And then with the cadence, it's straight up Savage Garden. That Savage Garden song that was a huge hit at the time. Shit, how did it go? Every time I want to see your face, it just goes not as, and I am taken to a place of your crystal mind and magenta. That whole thing.
And I am taken to a place of your crystal mind and magenta. Feeling take a chapter in the face of my spine, straight like a chicken cherry cola. I don't need to try to explain, I just hold on tight. And if it happens again, I'ma move so silently to the arms.
Growing up, I mean, John and I were on a steady diet of punk rock, weird shit, ordering from the K Records catalog.
Oh yeah.
You know,
that's awesome.
Everything from, I mean, your band to Jawbreaker, the Mises, like all of this stuff. But then we were also very much listening to the radio. And I think
those factors combined to make this song that on paper would have been an impossible, you know, Inside Out would have been, it's an impossible pop radio hit. But it's like a friend of mine said this once, like, hit songs are so weird because more often than not, it's like they are literally weird. There's something about them that they have as much a chance of being a fucking stiff as they do of going. It's not like
what I mean? It's such lightning in the bottle. Yeah. It's such lightning in the bottle stuff. You can't. And that's why I said it's just your story in and of itself. It's amazing. There's not many people can say they had a hit single on the radio, you know, and why was this a hit and somebody else's song that's great wasn't? We don't know. You'll never know.
You'll never know. It's so strange. And especially at a time when there was literally zero guitar on the radio. I mean, this was when Inside Out came out. It was like second wave of techno, Lilith Fair, you know, Sarah McLachlan stuff. Like there weren't electric guitars, you know? So it was like,
yeah, it was kind of jangly pop stuff. It wasn't, you're right. This fourth chorus here, comes in, and I know you mentioned that Don thought there was a lot of stuff here. I noticed that none of the choruses changed lyrically. Well, the very end of this one does, but it's kind of like an outro, but there's a lot of information in this chorus. It's not a refrain sung over and over. Turn it inside out. You know, it's a lot of lyrics. So was that conscious of, like, you know, did you ever say, hey, I want to change this line here, Don? And Don was like, no, we got to keep this. There's enough here.
No, Don was very authoritarian, I think, in a way that was really served us, being as like inexperienced as we were. He would be the one to say, Max, this lyric needs to change. He wouldn't write the lyric, but he would be like, this part can be better. And he'd straight up say, like, who cares? Like this line makes, I don't care. Like, it's boring. You know, he would say that stuff, but he would do it in such a way that it made me want to go in and get it and dig and get creative. Whereas it's weird how that happens. Like some people who offer criticism, people I've worked with before, don't have that thing where, you know, it's very often an impediment to creativity. Like, it's, you know, it can close you off.
I've always said the best producers, they have a psychological component to them. They can get into they're not going to get into Max's head like they're going to get into Chris's head. You're a different human being. He has to approach you differently. The fact that he was able to do that, you know, when we're younger, our, you know, I don't know if you want to call it ego, a lot of times we're not able to take criticism, be it constructive or be it harsh criticism.
It's terrifying.
And the fact that,
yeah,
absolutely. And the fact that you guys were that young and you let Don in and he, like you said, challenged you and you said, you know what, I'm going to go off in the corner. I'm going to write this bridge. Or I'm going to make this lyric better. I want to be creative is the word you use. That is awesome. Chorus four, when you come in here, it's sung higher than any of the two full band previous choruses. You're singing it up and it lifts there. Was that always the same, or were you going to sing the chorus in the same notes as before, or was that a suggestion from Don?
It's a really good question. I hope my memory is serving me. I think that we had those. So the chords in the outro under the last chorus are the same chords as the bridge. So they're different from the chords in the first two choruses that are very strange and are, you know, so now the chord progression is very simple. It's B, E, A, E over and over again from the time you hit the verse till the end of the song. I think we had that arrangement as a band. I think that's the way we had it arranged. And so the melody of the first two choruses would not have worked.
Right. And did you work backwards if those chords were like that for the last chorus? When you went and wrote the bridge, were you like, I'm going to mine those last chorus chords to kind of fit into the bridge? Do you remember that's how that happened?
Well, I remember we'd already tracked the song and had that chordal blueprint. So when I was going in to write the bridge, I was like, okay, these are the chords I need to write this thing to.
On the line, swallow my doubt, turn it inside out, find nothing but faith in nothing, want to put my tender heart in a blender, watch it spin around to a beautiful oblivion, rendezvous, then I'm through. That whole part, there's a super high vocal harmony that comes in there. And again, for a last chorus, you want it to lift. There's also, at the very top of this chorus, you don't hear it in the other choruses, it's a cool picking arpeggiated guitar part that is only here in the fourth chorus. And it's just another thing. When we get down here to Rendezvous That I'm Through, there's this killer guitar feedback that comes in. And then for the last 30 seconds of the song, it almost sounds like another pair of stereo guitars or something comes in. It just gets big there at the end. Say, now I'm through with you, which is like the other choruses, and then you say through with you. I know Don mixed this. There's a cool vocal delay on the you there that kind of swirls around, and it's just gives you I don't know, just makes you feel a certain way. It's cool. There's no vocal harmony on that line, and there's no vocal harmony on the very last line, which also adds that personal touch. You just say rendezvous and I'm through with you, and the song ends.
That's the only line of the song that was recorded after the fact. The very last line of the song I sang at Electric Lady in New York City when we were mixing. I actually think he may have had the mix done or close to done. It was like, I need you to sing one last line on the song. And I hear it. I hear a different tone. You know, it was a different day. It was probably—
That's interesting.
I'm sure it was the same— not the same microphone, but the same microphone, but different room, different tone.
So when the song was all done, you're now a couple years removed from high school. You're in Electric Ladyland, a world-renowned studio with a producer. You're on a major label. When the song was done, you sang that last vocal. You're hearing it back. Did anybody, RCA, did you guys, anybody feel like this is a hit, or was it just another song on the record at that point?
Chris, I swear to God, when I got Inside Out, when I rewrote that verse, broke it to halftime, and got it in the form that was similar to the way it would end up, I remember getting to school in the morning, would have been 10th or 11th grade, and telling John, our guitar player, dude, I think this song could be on the radio. I remember saying
that is awesome.
I remember saying that. And it's like so pie in the sky, like, you know, whatever.
Because I know what me and my friends were writing in 11th grade. It just, nothing that would have had any chance of being on the radio at all. And this just doesn't seem, this song does not seem juvenile to me. There's some maturity here. You were ahead of your time as an 11th grader. That's really, really cool. So now, again, you were saying you thought this was a hit when you were a kid. You're in a studio a couple years later. Did you have the same feeling like, wow, we have something here?
Yeah. I mean, I had no doubt that like that was the song that was like the most special. And there was some disagreement about that among the label A&R guy, even Don, who thought that the song that would be our second single, Leech, should be the first single. It was the radio promo guy, Ron Poor at RCA, who was a fucking character, man. I mean, you know how these folks are.
guy at Capitol was a character.
Yeah, dude. He straight up heard the record, said Inside Out is a number one alternative song, and I'm going to get it there. You know, like, and the true, you know, egotism of a radio promo guy. But fucking God bless him, because he did. It was like fucking, you know, pointing to the stands and hitting a grand slam kind of thing. Like, he was like, I am going to take this to number one. And he didn't
rest, you know, and it was a slow climb up the chart. And there were many weeks where we got knocked back down and we were like, oh, it's over. And then it would start to creep back up. There were a lot of stations that didn't want to play the song because, like I said, it didn't necessarily fit the format of rock alternative, whatever it was called, radio at the time, especially the big cities who were like too cool for it. And he fucking did it.
That's awesome. Well, we're going to wrap up here in a moment. I just have to say a couple things. First of all, just shocked that you wrote this in high school. I can't even believe it. That's such a great story. And I gotta say, whatever it's worth, you're my favorite internet comedian. Your Twitter posts, okay. I mean, if you haven't checked out the E6 account, Max, you're on fire, okay. And I think what I love so much now more about talking to you, because this is the first time that Max and I have met. I know that the self-deprecating, I thought I was self-deprecating. Your self-deprecating humor, none of this is lost on you. The irony of, you know, we were in a high school, I wrote this track, and you got one of those slots, man. You got on the radio. Like, you were the biggest band for your 15 minutes in 98. You guys were it, you know? And that's really awesome. And to see you take a piss out of yourself is refreshing, and it's awesome. So if you haven't checked out the Eve6 Twitter, go check it out. And I just want to give you a chance right now to plug anything that you or the band may have coming up.
Sure. No, let me say, I really appreciate this. This is like really fun, and you're good at this.
Thank you. I appreciate that. It is a lot of fun.
Been a fan of your band since I was a kid. We have an EP that's done. The second single from it comes out tonight at midnight. Actually, it's called Can We Combine. The video will come out tomorrow, and it features two juggalos, female juggalos, so I guess juggalettes, playing board games. Juggalos are working class heroes. Excited about this video coming out. The EP is called Grim Value. It's going to come out in June. and we have a full length recorded as well. So after the EP comes out, you know, it'll be another month or two before we drop song one of the record. So we're kicking the band into a different gear and really enjoying the shit we're doing, which is, I don't know, it's hard for me to be objective about it. You know how it is, but
sure.
We're a three-piece rock band. It's like guitar, bass, drums, zero frills, and we're really pulling from our, I think our influences are maybe apparent on this stuff for the first time. So it's cool.
Awesome, man. Well, hey, thank you for taking the time to be on the show and break down the song. It was very interesting.
Thanks so much, Chris. I appreciate it, man. I'll see you out there.
What's up, everybody? I am Finn McKenty, host of the Punk Rock NBA podcast, part of the Sound Talent Media podcast network. My podcast is all about doing what you love for a living, and every week I sit down and talk to people who have done exactly that. For example, musicians like Tommy from Between the Buried and Me, Matt from Periphery, Lil Lotus and Shinigami, among many others, photographers, artists, designers, YouTubers like Glenn Fricker and Sarah Dici, and I unpack exactly how they got to where they are today with the goal of helping you do the same. So if that sounds cool, you can listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com, and I'll see you there.
As we near the end of the show, here's a band you might not know.
Welcome to this week's Band You Might Not Know. If you'd like your band to be considered for Krista Makes a Podcast, all you have to do is submit your song and bio to bandyoumightnotknow@gmail.com. This week's featured artist is Exo Pandemic from Pennsylvania. I really like this track. You can find their music on SoundCloud, and here's a snippet of their song, Western World.
The Wrap with Chris and Chris. So, Chris, I think I'm in the same camp as you. I don't think I would want anyone to hear songs that I was writing in 11th grade.
I'm still in shock. I'm not going to lie to you. The level of songwriting and craft, and I use the word maturity for a 16-year-old kid is, none of my friends or myself are writing songs like this in 11th grade.
I would have never guessed it in a million years that was the case. It's pretty impressive. One thing that you guys talked about in this episode that I thought was interesting, and it's a way that I write, is you kind of talked about the way you scat, the way you just sort of have these sounds come out of your mouth that are a lot of times placeholders for lyrics, but that's because your voice and the way these words form and come out of your mouth is music in itself. So sometimes there's that challenge of like, oh, I have this cool melody and the way that these sounds sound, and then trying to match lyrics up to those sounds and have it have the same effect. Sometimes that's a challenge. It's not easy.
Oh, yeah, I can totally relate to that because, you know, for the majority of my career, Vinny wrote the lyrics, you know, less than Jake's first drummer. And it's like, you know, I would scat these things out and he would be, you know, try to fit lyrics into it. And a lot of the times it worked beautifully. And other times it was like, no, we need another word here. And that's like, it has to say this. Those are my lyrics. So there was definitely some headbutting there, and it was difficult. But sometimes just and I use the word feeling. Sometimes those nonsensical words when you're on your couch strumming the acoustic, they hit you a certain way. And when you try to recreate them later, you can never get that original magic. So sometimes nonsensical words end up making it to the song.
I got to really give you guys and Less Than Jake a lot of credit because you do have a lot of lyrics in your songs that wouldn't normally be sung. There is a lot of information in a lot of your songs. And I think it was maybe a product of what you're talking about, where you have, you know, someone handing you a set of lyrics that is insistent upon those being the lyrics and then finding a way to match those to melodies. And you guys are sort of masters at that, man. It's pretty impressive.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, there'd be times when Vinny would hand me a full sheet of lyrics. And it's like, here it is. And nobody to this day, kudos to him, has ever written with the kind of imagery and the place that he came from that I've ever seen. He's just very unique lyricist, which not to in a bad light at all, but would present itself in difficult situations. Like, how am I going to sing this word? This is weird, you know, but like you said, we made it work.
Hey, I'm jealous of you guys. I know you're one of these guys, but played in a band for all these years, done my share of singing, but I'm not a guy even today that can instantaneously harmonize. I need to sit down for a minute with a guitar and see like, okay, what is it to harmonize with this? Sing along to the guitar and then go like, okay, I'm going to practice that a few times. Okay, I got it. Whereas so many of my friends can just, you know, off the top of their head, just start harmonizing. I just don't have that innate ability, and I'm jealous of you guys that can do it.
I learned from Roger, really. I mean, he was just the master at it from when I met him, and now it's just second nature. And Max had mentioned that too, where in the early days all he could hear is the root notes and the you know, the melody. He couldn't hear the harmony, and now I'm able to differentiate those. And It takes a minute, a lot of practice. And it sounds like Max has had the last 20 years to practice, and he's gotten better. I've definitely gotten better at it, but it's taken me a minute.
Yeah, I've gotten a little better at it over the years. Obviously, I've done it for a lot of years, but I still have those times where we're at practice and we're playing the song and it's coming to that part where it's the harmony. Maybe it's a 3-part harmony or something. And my brain goes to the main melody and I sing. A lot of times I'll end up singing like an octave of the main melody or something. I'm like, shit, that's not my part. And then we'll stop. I'll do my part fine on my own. But then we go back into the song and I do it again. I'm like, why, brain? Why? But it just takes a lot of practice, I guess.
Absolutely. Something else I loved was just, you know, the way that Max included and gave kudos to Don Gilmore, the producer. You know, these were young kids. Yeah, there was raw talent. The A&R person at RCA could see through it. There was something here. Don took that raw talent and he harnessed it. And he made it what it was. And he gave him credit for just a lot of the production stuff, the harmonies, different things. And the fact, being so young, that Max was able to take that criticism and want to be a better performer. That's very difficult for a young person. I thought that was very insightful.
Yeah, for sure. And hey, man, E6 had a decent amount of hits.
They did.
For sure. And they might not be done. They have a new album coming out, and they might not be done. Like, that Here's to the Night song was huge. Like, they were, I mean, you're talking late 90s into the 2000s, and it's not like, you know, they had a, they broke up for a while and came back, and I don't know. It's impressive. It's impressive to be able to, you know, they're not one hit wonders. They've had three or four hits for sure.
No, not at all. And Max, I know the listeners couldn't see it, but we talk over Zoom here, and just the look on his face when he was talking about, you know, because they had taken a hiatus for some years. They had broke up, and then the band got back together around 2012. And just when he was talking about the new material and getting back out there, you could just see that he's doing it because it's fun, and he wants to, and he loves it. And it was refreshing to see that.
Yeah, absolutely. You can't take for granted if you've had hits, and I don't think Max does at all. And I mean, that's so cool. And I didn't know what we were getting into today with Max. Obviously, he's had a big Twitter presence over the past 6 months or year or so. And I didn't know. He was very down to earth, cool guy, I thought. But I think there's something really awesome about not taking yourself so seriously. And I think every artist I've ever loved doesn't take themselves too seriously. You look at, like, the assholes who take themselves way too seriously. You look at the Morrisseys of the world, and you're like, I don't want to be like that. You know, it's, you can write from the heart, but still have a sense of humor about it.
Sure. And I liked when, you know, Max had a sense of humor. The story talking about, you know, taking a leak next to Fred Durst at some random bar about, you know, Fred pinching the lyric for Tender Heart in a Blender for Nookie, which came out like a year later, which is almost like, I can't remember what artist it was years ago was saying, you know, you've made it when Weird Al is covering your song. And, you know,
right,
not to compare Limp Bizkit to Weird Al, but in a sense, you know, Limp Bizkit was pretty much the biggest band on the planet in 1999 when that Nookie song came out. And so I think Max kind of took that as, you know what, I'm in a pretty damn big band if the next big band use my lyric in a song, which I thought that was a cool take.
Yeah, for sure. We were talking about that a little bit before you even started recording this episode, and you talked about it in the episode, but Max kind of confirmed with his urinal story, but I kind of thought, yeah, maybe he did that on purpose. It wasn't that he ripped the lyric off. It was more like a direct reference to that song that was probably still on the radio. Yeah, it had to still be on the radio when that song came out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think that's exactly what it was. I don't think I'm going to steal the lyric. I think it was, hey, this is a in the now pop culture thing, and I'm going to use it in the song to reference it. So I don't think there was any ill intention on Fred's part.
And hey, Chris, speaking of intentions, there's a lot of Chris DeMakes a Podcast listeners with some really great intentions when it comes to our monthly fundraiser.
That's right, Chris. We could not do it without all of our listeners. You guys are amazing and so generous each and every month. This month's fundraiser is the National Brain Tumor Society. That's who we're going to partner up with. And as many of you know, Craig Aronson was Less Than Jake's A&R person over at Capitol Records and Warner Brothers Records. So this month's fundraiser really hits home. Craig passed away from a brain tumor back in 2014, and his wife Britt has been an amazing advocate for this organization, and they focus on defeating brain tumors and improving the quality of patients' lives. And basically, that's what the money would be going to and to research, which is the most important thing. So if you could, please head over to ChrisDeMakesADifference.com, give a dollar, five, ten, whatever you can spare, and it would go to an amazing cause.
Yeah, this is a really awesome fundraiser this month, man. I've heard you talk about Craig both on the podcast and just you and I talking to each other so much. I know that not only was he an important part of your band story, but he was also a great friend to you. I've heard so much about him. So if anyone out there can contribute a few bucks, this is a really great fundraiser this month, man.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. His wife's just been amazing. She goes to Washington, D.C. each and every year. She's there just relentless in her pursuit to find a cure for this thing, because it's absolutely devastating. So thanks to each and every one of you. You could head over to ChrisDeMakesADifference.com and give whatever you can. That'd be fantastic. And What else we got, Chris? I still would like you to give me a follow on Instagram. I post some funny stuff sometimes. Go give me a follow at Less Than Chris D. And if you haven't already, we'd love for you to join our Facebook group. It's a lot of fun. I want to give a shout out to a couple members in the group. It's free to join. I want to say hello to Mr. Adam Williams and Miss Julie Goldsberry. Thank you for being members. And speaking of members, if you had an Etsy shop and you had a members only VIP program, I would be a part of that, Chris, but you don't. But you should talk about your Etsy shop anyways.
You really like enamel pins that much. I still got to make a Chris DeMakes one. But yeah, I have an Etsy shop. If you guys are a fan of pins, head over to iloveenamelpins.com and you can use the discount code Chris DeMakes to get 30% off your order. I got a lot of pins. I mean, you can get yourself a Golden Girls pin. If you like cats, I got plenty of cat pins. I got everything you can imagine. And yeah, hey, thanks for the plug, man.
Hey, no problem. Like I said, I like your pins. They're awesome. And one last thing, got an exciting announcement for next week on June 9th. The next single from my book, Blast from the Past, is coming out. The song is called Father Time, and we'll be debuting it on next week's show.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. Great song. I know a lot of people out there picked up the 7-inch already, but there might be a few copies left over at chrisdemakesabook.com. It's in support of your book, Blast from the Past, and you don't want to miss out on this one, especially, I brought it up before, but the cover of this 7-inch is incredible. And just like on your Instagram page, we need more teenage Chris DeMakes school photos. We need more.
And by amazing, Chris means absolutely ridiculous. That's what this cover is. Yeah, if you'd like to check out the 7-inch and the book and all the other stuff associated with it, you can go to chrisdemakesabook.com. It's all there in its glory. And I want to thank this week's guest, Max Collins from Eve 6, for sitting in the hot seat with us. It was a great episode. Until then, we'll see you next week.
Mad Magazine.
Advertising mascots.
B-movie posters.
And cartoons.
Oh yeah, can't forget cartoons.
If you get the funky connection that ties these pop culture gems together, you'll dig two designers walk into a bar.
See, we're a couple of creatively curious pals living between the bookends of grand museums and dive bars.
Hey, you know the place, the sweet spot where highbrow and lowbrow become drinking buddies.
So join our barroom chats as we talk influential work and uncover stories of how the familiar became iconic. Think behind the music for the stuff we love.
Check out our website at twodesignerswalkintoabar.com.
And listen wherever you get your podcasts or visit evergreenpodcasts.com.
Hey there, I am Johnny Christ from Avenged Sevenfold, and I've got a podcast called Drinks with Johnny you're going to want to check out. I sit down with a bunch of different people from all different walks of life, from professional wrestlers to actors, comedians, fighters, musicians, everything in between. I'm just looking to make some friends and have a good time doing it. So if that sounds like something you're into, go check out Drinks with Johnny, streaming everywhere now.